of motion. Introduction. In the preceding chapter, the concern was to describe motion of a particle in space quantitatively. We saw that uniform motion needs a concept of velocity alone, whereas non-uniform motion requires a concept of acceleration in addition. So far, we have asked the question as to what governs the motion of objects. In this chapter, we turn to learn about this basic question. Let us first guess the answer based on a common experience. We throw a football at rest. We throw a stone upward, move from an upward direction. A breeze causes the branches of a tree to swing. A strong wind can even move heavy objects. A boat moves in a flowing river. Clearly, some external agency is needed to provide force to move a body from rest. Likewise, an external force is needed also to retard or stop motion. You can stop a ball rolling down an inclined plane by applying a force against the direction of its motion. In this example, the external agencies of force, hand, wind, stream, etc. is in contact with the motion, with the object. This is because not only necessary, but is also irresistible. A stone released from the top of a building accelerates downward due to gravitational force of the earth. A bar magnet can attract an iron nail from a distance. This shows that external agencies, gravitational force, can exert force on a body even from a distance. In short, a force is required to put a necessary body, stationary body, into motion or stop a moving body, and some external agency is needed to pull this force. The external agency may or may not be in contact with the body. So far so good, but what if a body is moving uniformly, that is a skater moving straight with constant speed on a horizontal ice slab? Is an external force required to keep a body in uniform motion? Aristotle's vacillate. The question posed above appears to be single, however, it took ages to answer it. Indeed, the correct answer to this question was given by Galileo in the 17th century, was that the foundation of Newtonian mechanics was signaled by the birth of modern science. The Greek thinkers held this view that if a body is moving, something external is required to keep it moving. According to this view, for example, an arrow shot from a bow keeps flying since the air behind the arrow keeps pushing it forward. The view was a part of an elaborate framework of ideas developed by Aristotle on the motion of bodies in the universe. Most of the Aristotelian ideas on motion are now known to be wrong and need to be concerned. For our purpose here, Aristotelian laws may be phrased thus. An external force is required to keep a body in motion. Aristotelian laws are flawed, as we shall see. However, it is natural view that anyone, a small child playing on a floor, knows that intuitively a toy car needs to be pulled with a string in order to move it forward, and as soon as it stops or leaves the string, the toy car stops moving. When the flaw of Aristotle, what is the flaw of Aristotle's argument? The answer is the moving car comes to rest because the external force on the car by the flaw opposes its motion. To counter this force, the child needs to keep moving in the same direction. The opposing forces, such as friction, solids and viscous forces or fluids, are always present in the natural world. This less explains why forces by external agencies are necessary. Now we understand where Aristotle went wrong. To get an idea of what the true law is for forces and motion, one has to imagine a world in which uniform motion is possible and non-frictional forces opposing what Galileo did. The law of inertia. Galileo studied motion of objects on an inclined plane, objects moving down an inclined plane while those moving up returned. Motion on a horizontal plane is intermediate situation. Galileo concluded that an object moving on a frictionless horizontal plane must either have acceleration nor retardation. Another experiment by Galileo leading to the same conclusion involves a double inclined plane. A ball released from rest or one of the plane rolls smooth. The final height of the ball is nearly the same as that of the initial height. In this ideal situation, when friction is absent, the final height of the ball is the same as that of the initial height. If the slope of the second plane is decreased and the experiment is repeated, the ball will still reach to the same height, but in doing so, it will travel a longer distance. In the limiting case, when the second slope is zero, the ball travels a minute distance. In other words, an idealized situation occurs. In practice, the ball comes to stop after moving an infinite distance on a horizontal plane. However, if there was no friction, the ball would continue to move with a constant velocity on a horizontal plane. Galileo thus arrived at a new site of motion, and that eluded Aristotle and all the others that followed him. The state of rest of uniform linear motion, motion with constant force are equivalent in both cases. No net force acting on the body. It is incorrect to assume that a net force is acting on a body to keep the body uniform. To maintain a body in uniform motion, we need to apply an external force to encounter it. To summarize this, if the external force is zero, a body at rest continues to remain at rest, and a body in motion continues to remain in uniform motion. Newton's first law of motion. Galileo's simple but revolutionary ideas destroyed Aristotle mechanics. A new mechanics has developed, and this task was accomplished by single-handedly by Isaac Newton, one of the greatest scientists of all time. Everybody continues to be in a state of motion in a straight line unless compelled by some external force to act otherwise. The state of rest of uniform motion accelerated or zero acceleration. Two kinds of situations are encountered in application of this law in practice. In some companies, we know that the net external force on the body is zero, and that in that case, we can conclude that acceleration of the object is zero. For example, a spaceship out in interstellar space far from our objects with an external force of the rockets turned off has no jet external force according to the first law, and it must be zero. If it is in motion, it must continue to move with a uniform velocity. More often, however, we do not know all the forces to begin with. In this case, if we know that an object is accelerated, unaccelerated, that is, it is either at rest or in uniform motion, we can either infer from the first law that net external force on the body is zero. For terrestrial phenomena in particular, every object requires gravitational force due to the earth. Also, objects in motion experience experimental friction. If then on earth an object is at rest or in uniform linear motion, it is because there are no forces acting on it, but also because various external forces add up to zero external force. Consider a book at rest on a horizontal surface. It is a subject to two external forces, the force due to gravity its weight W acting downward and upward on the book from the table. The normal force R, R is self-adjusting force. It is an example of the kind of situation mentioned above. The forces are not quite fully mentioned, but the state of motion is known. We observe the book at rest. Therefore, we conclude that the first law, that magnitude R equals to that of W, and a statement was encountered. Since W is equal to R, forces cancel. Since the book is observed to be at zero at rest, the net external force is zero. Normal force must be equal to or opposite to the weight. Consider the motion of a car moving from rest, picking up speed and then moving from a smooth straight on a smooth straight road. When a car is stationary, there are no forces or motion acting on it. During pickup, there is a certain level of energy with which the car gets a push. Note it as to be the external force. The acceleration of the car cannot be accounted by an instrument, but it is surprisingly true. When the car moves with a constant velocity, there is no external force. This property of inertia obtained in the first law is evident in many situations. Suppose we are standing in a stationary bus and the bus driver starts the bus suddenly. Now we get thrown backward with a jerk. Why? Our feet are in touch with the ground. If there were no friction, we would remain where we are, while the floor on this bus would simply slip forward under our feet and back and forth. But our body is not strictly a rigid body, it is deformable. It allows some relative displacement between the parts. What is meant by what this is meant is that while our feet go along with the bus, the rest of the body remains where it is relative to the bus. Therefore, we are thrown backward. As soon as it happens, similar thing as stop happens. Our feet stops due to the motion between our feet and the floor of the bus, but the rest of the body continues to move forward during inertia. If we throw a body upward, the restoring muscles again comply to it. Second law of motion. The first law refers to a simple case when the net external force on the body is zero. The second law of motion refers to a general situation when there is a net force zero acting on the body. It relates that the next external force to acceleration is momentum. Momentum of a body is defined to be the product of mass of the body and velocity of the body. P is equal to mv. Momentum is clearly a vector quantity, and the following common experience indicates the importance of quantity for considering effect of force of motion. Suppose a lightweight vehicle, say a small car, and a heavy vehicle, say a loaded truck, are parked on a horizontal road. We know that there is much greater force needed to push the truck than the car. Bring them in the same speed at the same time. Similarly, greater opposing force is needed to stop a heavy body than a light body in the same time. Impulse. We sometimes encounter examples where a large force acts on a small body for a very short duration, producing a finite change in momentum of the body. For example, when a ball hits a wall and bounces back, the force on the ball by the wall acts for a very short time when the two are in contact, yet the force is large. enough to reverse the momentum of the burn. Often in this situation, the force is separable. However, the product of force and time, which is the change of momentum of the body, remains measurable, a measurable quantity. This product is called impulse. A large force acting for a short time produces a finite change. In this history, science, impulsive forces are put in an exceptionally different category from ordinary forces, and Newton's mechanics has no such distinct direction. Impulse forces, like any other force except that of a large force, acts for a short time. Newton's third law of motion. The third law states that the external force of a body to its acceleration.
What is the origin
of such a force? What agency provides this external force? In Newtonian mechanics, it is true that an external force moves a body. A natural question arises as to what this external force is. Does A in turn give rise to an external force on B? In some examples, the answer seems to be compressed by the force of your hand. The force of the spring turns into a force on the earth. The answer, according to Newton, is yes. The stone does not exert an equal or opposite force on the earth. We do not have to notice it, since the earth is very massive and the effect of force is in the motion is negligible. To every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction. Newton's wordings of the third law are so crisp and beautifully written that it becomes a part of a common language. For the same reason, perhaps misconceptions to this law are bound. To every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction. Let us note some important points about this third law. Action and reaction. The terms action and reaction in the third law are nothing but force. Using different terms for the physical concept can sometimes be confusing. A simple and clear way of stating the third law is force occurs in between two pairs. Force on A by B is equal to the opposite of the force of B on A. The terms action, reaction, third law may give a wrong impression that action comes before reaction. Action is the cause of a reaction, the effect. There is no cause-effect relationship implied in the third law. The force on A and by B and B by A is the same instance of time. Conservation of momentum. The second and third laws lead to an important consequence, the laws of conservation of momentum. A bullet fired from a gun. Take a familiar example. A bullet fired from a gun. If the force on the bullet of the gun is F and the force on the gun is minus F, then the two forces act at common intervals. According to the second law, F into delta T is a change in momentum of the object. Minus F into delta T is a change of momentum of the gun. Since the initial object is both at rest, momentum equals to the final momentum for each. PV is equal to the momentum of the bullet after firing, and PQ is equal to the momentum of the recoil of the gun. The total momentum of the bullet plus gun system is conserved. The total momentum is of an isolated system or interacting particles is conserved. An important example of the application of new laws of conservation of momentum, there is collision of the bodies. Consider two bodies A and B of initial PA and PB momentum. The bodies collide and get apart with the first momenta P dash A and second momenta P dash B. Equilibrium of a particle. equilibrium of a particle is mechanics, is refers to the situation where the net external force on the particle is zero. According to the first law, this means that the particle is either at rest or at motion. The two forces F1 and F2 act on a particle in equilibrium. F1 is equal to minus F2, and the two forces on the particles must be equal to the opposite force. In other words, the resultant of any two forces of the same F1 and F2 are obtained and must be equal and opposite to the third force, F3. As seen, the three forces of equilibrium can be represented by the sides of a triangle. The result can be generalized for any number of forces. ELX is equal to E2X is equal to A3 plus E3X is equal to 0. Common forces in mechanics. In mechanics, we encounter several kinds of forces. The external force is the cause of pervasive nature. Every object on the earth experiences a force of gravity due to the earth. Gravity is also governing the motion of celestial bodies and the gravitational force required for the same. The two common forces are tension and tension in the string and the force due to the spring. What is common is compressed or extended by external force, usually proportional to the compression or elongation of the compressed displacements. F is equal to minus kf, where x is the distance or the displacement of an unstretched state. For an extensible string, the force constant is the tension, and this is customary to use a constant tension T throughout this object. In chapter 1, we learn that there are four fundamental forces in nature. Of these, the three are strong forces and appear in the domains that do not concern us here. Only the gravitational forces and the electrical forces are relevant in the context of mechanics. The new context of forces can be mentioned fundamentally. Friction. Friction, let us return to the example of a body of mass M on a horizontal table. The body of the force of gravity is cancelled by the normal reaction on the table. Now, suppose the force F is applied horizontally on the body. We know that a force may not apply on it. Clearly, the body remains at rest because some of the other forces come to rest in because of it. The force Fs is parallel to the surface of the body and in contact with the table is known as frictional force. When there is no applied force, there is no static friction, and it comes into play that the moment there is an applied force, as the applied force F increases, Is is equal to Fs increases, applying equal and opposite forces. Keeping in mind the body at rest, hence it is called static motion. Rolling friction. A body or a ring is said to be rolling over a horizontal surface and will suffer no friction. In principle, at every instance, there is one point of contact between the body and the plane, and this point has no motion relative to the plane. In this ideal situation, kinetics stands strong and still against these parts. In many situations, however, friction is critically needed. Kinetic friction that dissipates power is nevertheless more important and quickly stoppable than relative friction. It has made us use life much easier. It has made our life much easier, and we are able to walk because of the friction. Summary. Aristotle's law that a force necessary to keep a body in uniform motion is wrong. Galileo extrapolated simple observations of motions of bodies on inclined planes and arrived to the law of inertia. Everybody continues to be in a state of motion and in a straight line. Momentum of a body is a product of its mass and velocity. The Newton's second law of motion, the rate of change of momentum of a body is proportional to the applied force. F is equal to minus k dp upon dt. SI is equal to the force in Newton. 1N is equal to 1 kg and F is the point of external instance acting on this. Impulse is a product of force and force and time are equal and opposite in nature. Every action there is an equal and opposite reaction. Law of conservation, the total momentum of an isolated system of a particle is conserved. The law of follows from a sensed and third law of motion. Friction is something that opposes or implements the actual relative behavior between two surfaces. It is the component of the constant force along the common tangent of the surface.